So, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We continue with كتاب الطهارة, Book of Purity, in المحلة. We are at page 108 and issue 122, line 19-25. مسألة 122, وتطهير القبل والدبر من البول والغائط والدم من الرجل والمرأة لا يكون إلا بالماء حتى يزول الأثر وبثلاثة أحجار متغايرة, فإن لم ينقي فعلى الوتر أبدا يزيد كذلك حتى ينقى لا أقل من ذلك, ولا يكون في شيء منها غائط أو بالتراب أو الرمل بلا عدد, ولكن ما أزال الأثر فقط على الوتر, ولا بد ولا يجزئ أحدا أن يستنجي بيمينه ولا هو مستقبل القبلة. فإن بدأ بمخرج البول أجزأ تلك الأحجار بأعيانها لمخرج الغائط, وإن بدأ بمخرج الغائط لم يجزئ من تلك الأحجار لمخرج البول إلا ما كان لا رجيع عليه فقط. And he's summarizing various issues in this issue number 22 and purifying both the front and end exit points from urine and excrement and blood, both for men and women, is possible only with water until there's no traces left, or with three stones, or equivalent to stones like paper in modern times, which are different. If it is not cleaned, then increase the number until it is clean. But all wither, 3, 5, 7, not 4, not 6. It has to be wither, 3, 5, 7, etc., until it's cleaned, and nothing less than that. And in these stones or pieces of paper, there should be no excrement. If there's an excrement, they cannot be used for purification. They must be thrown away. They have to be having no excrement, not urine, but no excrement. Or using dust or sand without number, because this some people will rub it and will be able to clean it without number, because obviously sand and cannot be counted until any trace is gone. And if it's not permissible, it will not purify him if he does the istinja with his right hand. It has to be with the left hand and not facing al-Qibla, because the hadith prohibits that. And his general school of thought is that if something is prohibited, then the result of using violating the prohibition is that the result is invalid. So the purity is not achieved. Purity is not achieved.
Even if it's physically achieved.
Even if it's physically achieved, because there's a command has come. That's his point of view, and it has some points have been to be obviously addressed to that. If he starts with the urine place, with the penis or whatever the place of getting it, then the same stones can be turned in the other side, used to remove the excrement. If he starts with the excrement place, then the stones are having excrement, they cannot be used again. They have to be thrown another stones to be used for the urine place. Then he starts mentioning now the evidences for that bit by bit, and we'll discuss at the end. From line 26 in this page 108 until line 6, the next page 109. حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف, حدثنا أحمد بن فتح, حدثنا عبد الوهاب بن عيسى, حدثنا أحمد بن محمد, حدثنا أحمد بن علي, حدثنا الإمام مسلم بالحجاج, حدثنا محمد بن المثنى, حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن المهدي, حدثنا سفيان الثوري عن الأعمش ومنصور بن معتمر كلاهما عن إبراهيم النخعي عن عبد الرحمن بن يزيد عن سلمان الفارسي قال قال لنا المشركون إني أرى صاحبكم يعلمكم كل شيء حتى يعلمكم القراءة, فقال سلمان أجل إنه نهانا أن يستنجي أحدنا بيمينه أو يستقبل القبلة, ونهانا عن الروث والعظام, وقال لا يستنجي أحدكم بدون ثلاثة أحجار. تولد أس عبد الله بن يوسف, تولد أس أحمد بن فتح, تولد أس عبد الوهاب بن عيسى, تولد أس أحمد بن محمد, تولد أس أحمد بن علي, تولد أس مسلم بن الحجاج, تولد أس محمد بن المثنى, تولد أس عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, تولد أس سفيان الثوري, from الأعمش أن منصور بن عتمر, both of them from إبراهيم النخعي, from عبد الرحمن بن يزيد, from Salman al-Farisi. He said, the Mushrikeen said to him, we see that your friend, or your companion, meaning the Prophet, they are mocking, yeah, the friend, teaching everything, including how to defecate, mockingly. Salman patiently answered, said, indeed, he commanded us, he prohibits us that we do istinja, meaning cleaning both exits, with our right hand, or while facing the Qibla, and he prohibited us to use animal droppings, which are sometimes hard like stone, so they may appear and they're not smelly, and they have been hit with the sun, so they appear like stone. Some Arabs used to use them for cleaning, and also bones. He has prohibiting these two, and he said nobody of you should purify with less than three stones. next, that's the hadith itself. Next evidences from 7 to 11 in page 109 told us Muhammad ibn Sa'id ibn Nabat, told us Abdullah ibn Nasr, told us Qasim ibn Asbagh, told us Muhammad ibn Waddah, told us Musa ibn Muawiyah, told us Waqi' ibn al-Jarrah, from Al-A'mash, from Ibrahim al-Nakhai, from Abdurrahman ibn Yazid, and Salman al-Farisi. Actual identity the Arabic, let me the Arabic first. حدثنا محمد بن سعيد بن نبات, حدثنا عبد الله بن نصر, حدثنا قاسم بن أصبغ, حدثنا محمد بن وضاح, حدثنا موسى بن معاوية, حدثنا وكيع بن الجراح, عن الأعمش, عن إبراهيم النخعي, عن عبد الرحمن بن يزيد, عن سلمان الفارسي, إن بعض المشركين قال لي إني لأرى صاحبكم يعلمكم حتى القراءة, قال أجل, أمرنا أن لا نستقبل القبلة ولا نستنجي بأيماننا ولا نكف بدون ثلاثة حجار ليس فيهن رجيع ولا عظم. تولد اس محمد بن سعيد بن نبات, تولد اس عبد الله بن نصر, تولد اس قاسم بن أصبغ, تولد اس محمد بن وضاح, تولد اس موسى بن معاوية, تولد اس وكيع بن الجراح, from الأعمش, from إبراهيم النخعي, from عبد الرحمن بن يزيد, from سلمان الفارسي. Some of the مشركين told him, we see that your friend is teaching you even how to defecate. سلمان responded, indeed, he ordered us that we don't face al-Qibla or purify with our right hands, and we should not be sufficient with less than 3 stones. Under them no bone or an animal dropping. Another evidence, line 12 to 15, حدثنا عبد الله بن ربيع, حدثنا محمد بن معاوية, حدثنا أحمد بن شعيب هو النسائي, حدثنا إسحاق بن إبراهيم هو بن راهوية, حدثنا أبو معاوية, حدثنا الأعمش, عن إبراهيم, عن عبد الرحمن بن يزيد, عن سلمان الفارسي قال إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نهانا أن نستقبل القبلة لغائط أو بول أو أن نستنجي بأيمان أو نكتفي بأقل من 3 أحجار. أنا ذكرت ابن ريشن, حدثنا تولس عبد الله بن ربيع, تولس محمد بن معاوية, تولس أحمد بن شعيب النسائي, تولس إسحاق بن إبراهيم ابن راهوية, تولس أبو معاوية, تولس الأعمش, from إبراهيم, from عبد الرحمن بن يزيد, from سلمان الفارسي. He said the messenger of Allah prohibited us that we face al-Qibla for urine or defecation, or that we make a istinja with our right hands, or that we will be ever suffice with less than 3 stones. Line 16 to 18. حدثنا أحمد بن محمد بن الجسور, حدثنا أحمد بن سعيد, حدثنا عبيد الله بن يحيى بن يحيى, حدثنا أبي, حدثنا مالك إمام مالك, عن ابن شهاب, عن أبي إدريس الخولاني, عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وإذا استجمرت فأوتر. Did I mix Arabic with English here? I think so. Let me read the Arabic. Was Arabic? Yeah. Now we go to the English. Told us Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn al-Jasur, told us Ahmad ibn Sa'id, told us Ubaidullah ibn Yahya ibn Yahya, told us Abi, told us Malik. This is Malik chain. From Ibn Shihab, from Abi Idris al-Khawlani, from Abi Huraira, that the Messenger of Allah said, if you do istijmar, meaning removing the aft, then do it outer. Do it in odd number. One is not permissible because we spoke about three, so it'll be 3, 5, etc. It has to be with. Ibn Shihab, sorry, yes, this is. No, Malik taking from Ibn Shihab. Yeah, Malik taking from Ibn Shihab. Yeah, Malik from Ibn Shihab. Ibn Shihab is the teacher of Malik. Yeah, it's well known. Yeah, it says here clearly Malik from Ibn Shihab. Next piece of evidence, page 110, from line 1 until 8. حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد, حدثنا إبراهيم بن أحمد, حدثنا الفرابري, حدثنا البخاري, حدثنا محمد بن بشار, حدثنا محمد بن جعفر, حدثنا شعبة, عن عطاء بن أبي ميمونة, سمع أنس بن مالك قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يدخل خلاء فأحمل أنا وغلام إداوة من ماء وعنزة يستنجي بالماء. حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف, حدثنا أحمد بن فتح, حدثنا عبد الوهاب بن عيسى, حدثنا أحمد بن محمد, حدثنا أحمد بن علي, حدثنا مسلم بن الحجاج, حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد, حدثنا إسماعيل هو بن جعفر, عن علاء بن عبد الرحمن, عن أبيه, عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وجعلت الأرض طهورا ومسجدا, ورويناه أيضا من طريق جابر مسندا. تولد أس عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد, تولد أس إبراهيم بن أحمد, تولد أس الفرابري, تولد أس البخاري إمام بخاري, تولد اس محمد بن بشار هو هذا النيك نيم بندار, تولد اس محمد بن جعفر هو هذا النيك نيم غندر, just for your information. تولد اس شعبة, عن عطاء ابن ابي ميمونة, from عطاء ابن ابي ميمونة, he heard Anas ibn Malik saying that the messenger of Allah used to go to the loo or to the bathroom, so I carry myself and another boy a jug of water and a small spear for protection, and so that he uses water for purification, which is clear, does not need water, is very evident, clarifying.
It's a spear for God and the Prophet.
Or whatever, just putting it maybe to shield it from the Kaaba, because if you pray to a Hanazah, it will shield you from the Kaaba, something, it's not clear.
There's
it could be for that. And then told us Abdullah ibn Yusuf, told us Ahmed ibn Fath, this is his chain for a Muslim, told us Abdullah ibn Isa, told us Ahmed ibn Muhammad, told us Ahmed ibn Ali, told us Muslim ibn al-Hajjaj, told us Qutayb ibn Sa'id, told us Ismail, this Ismail, he is Ibn Abi Ja'far, Ibn Ja'far, Ismail ibn Ja'far the Madani, from Al-Ala, the son of Abdurrahman, from his father, from Abi Huraira, that the Messenger of Allah said, وَجُعِلَتِي الْأَرْضُ غَوْرًا وَمَسْجِدًا. All the earth has been made for me a masjid, a place of prayer, and a tawr, a purification agent. And he said, Ibn Hazm said, and we narrated it also from Ma'jabir with its isnad. So this is further evidence. Is now from 9 to 16 further pieces. Now comments. قال أبو حنيفة ومالك بأي شيء استنجدون عدد فأنقى أجزاءه، وهذا خلاف ما أمر به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، لأنه نهى أن يكتفي أحد بدون ثلاثة أحجار، وأمره بالبتر في الاستجارة. ما نعلم له متعلقا إلا أنهم ذكروا أثرا فيه أن عمر رضي الله عنه كان له عظم أو حجر يستنجي به ثم يتوضأ ويصلي، وهذا لا حجة فيه لأنه شك، إما حجر وإما عظم، وقد خالف عمر في المسح على العمامة وغير ذلك. ولصح لكان لا حجة في أحد دون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، لا سيما وقد خالفه سلمان وغيره من الصحابة رضي الله عنهم، فأخبروا أن حكم الاستنجاء هو ما علمه يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أن لا يكتفى بدون ثلاثة أحجار. أبو حنيفة المالك said whatever he uses for استنجاء so that it becomes clean it will be sufficient. And this is Ibn Hazm, I'm just saying, I will comment. And this is against what the Messenger of Allah has ordered, because he has prohibited that you would be sufficed with less than 3 stones, and he ordered witr, 3, 5, etc. for istijmar. And we don't know any reference they have, except that they mentioned that Umar used to have a stone or a bone with which he used it for istinja. And then he makes wudu, then he prays. And this is not an argument, because it is not clear. It says either a stone or a bone. So they cannot conclude that he was using a bone. It may be a stone, maybe a bone. This is doubt, and doubt is not an evidence. And they have, and if they are following Umar, this why they are not following him, that in touching above the head cover, the imama. Umar used to wipe over the imama. They say, no, you cannot wipe over the imama. So why is Umar, he's an authority? Then why don't take him in this? So and in other issues, so why you are not following him in that? ولو صح لكان لا حجة. And if it even established that Umar used a bone, he is not an authority against Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Specifically, since Umar is being contradicted by Salman and all other companions, and also the companions have narrated that the Messenger of Allah ordered the istinja the way Salman has said. Let me just comment one point there, and let's continue, because the other point is relevant, and the general comment will cover all of them. Then from line 17 and 23, the end of the page, فإن قيل أمره عليه السلام بثلاث أحجار هو الغائط والبول معا، فوقع لكل واحد منهم أقل من ثلاث أحجار. قلنا هذا باطل، لأن نص قد ورد بأن لا نستنجي بأقل من ثلاثة أحجار، ومسح البول لا يسمى استنجاء، فحصل نص في الاستنجاء والقراءة أن لا يجزي أقل من ثلاثة أحجار، وحصل نص مجملا في أن لا يجزي أقل من ثلاثة أحجار على البول نفسه وعلى النجو، فصح ما قلنا. ومسح البول باليمين جائز، وكذلك مستقبل القبلة، لأنه لم ينهى عن ذلك في البول، وإنما هي في الاستنجاء فقط. It's becoming extremely loud, he said. If they say the command of the Messenger of Allah to use 3 stones is both for excrement and urine, both, so each one of them will be less than 3, we respond to them, this is invalid, because the command has come clearly that it to do use for istinja 3 stones. And istinja means removing the excrement, not the urine. It's not called istinja. Istinja is only for using from the aft in the Arabic language. And removing the masah al-bawl is called masah, is not called istinja. Laysa mastinja, cannot be called istinja. So the nas is clear that it is for the aft and for the excrement, at least 3 are needed. And the text is general about urine. For urine, you can be less than 3. It can, and he says also removing the urine with the right hand. There's no prohibition. It's only the istinja, not for the right hand. And also facing a qibla. It's become now extreme literal, because the words came only istinja, only istinja. Let me continue and make the final comment. وقال الشافعي ثلاث مسحات بحجر واحد. This is line 1 until line 9 until line 5. وقال الشافعي ثلاث مسحات بحجر واحد وأجاز الاستنجاء بكل شيء حاش العظم والروث والحممة والقصب والجلود التي لم تدبغ. وهذا أيضا خلاف لأمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بأن لا يكتفي بأقل من ثلاثة أحجار. فإن قالوا قسنا على الأحجار قلنا لهم فقيسوا على التراب في التيمم ولا فرق. الشافعي سيد and the Safi said three wipes are necessary with one stone is possible and he permitted to make istinja removing that excrement by everything except bone because of the hadith and rauth the animal droppings and humama which is the ashes from the fire the remaining ashes after the fire and from qasab which is like bamboo sticks he did not permit and skins which have not been tanned.
And he permitted or didn't permit?
He did not permit that.
Shafi.
Yeah, Shafi.
Okay.
And this is again violating the command of the Messenger of Allah not to use less than three stones. If they say we have made qiyas on the stones, we tell them that make qiyas on the dust in the case of tayammum. So what's the difference? If you make qiyas on stones on water or something like that, then make qiyas on the dust with the tayammum. And in the case of tayammum, you can make tayammum with the ashes because it's burned and pure after fire. Everything is burned and pure. Yeah. You can make it. So what's the difference? So the qiyas is not on consistent grounds. Let's continue and then we comment maybe at the end because there were some general comments. فإن ذكروا six until ten. فإن ذكروا line 6 until line 10. فإن ذكروا حديث رواه ابن أخي الزهري مسند أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا تغوط أحدكم فليتمسح ثلاث مرات. قيل ابن أخي الزهري ضعيف والذي رواه عن محمد بن الكناني وهو مجهول. ولو صح لما كانت فيه حجة لأنه ليس فيها أن تلك المسحات تكون بحجر واحد فزيادة هذا لا تحل. If they use an argument that there's a hadith narrated by the cousin, the nephew of Zuhri with its isnad that the Messenger of Allah said if one of you defecate then he should wipe out three times at least. See, we respond to that the cousin, the nephew of Zuhri is weak. He's not a good memorizer. And the narrator from his, Muhammad ibn al-Kinani, is unknown. And unknown, we don't know what his level of accuracy and trustworthiness. And even if it's established, it's not an argument for that because it says he has to wipe three times and not saying with three different stones or one stone. And we have that hadith thing with three different stones. So this...
He's saying wipe, but he hasn't included maybe the Prophet.
They said just three times, but they didn't say three stones or one stone. They say this may be an argument for one stone, using the various size of the stone. Say no,
no.
But the other hadith says clearly that it's three different stones. So this will not be enough to violate the point of view. You see, it's going very excessive in these things in details, because the scholar got deeply involved in that. But I will make a general comment inshallah at the end, following our general comment previously. وأما ما قال أن حديث من استجمر فليوتر معارض. This is from from 11 until 16. وأما ما قال أن حديث من استجمر فليوتر معارض لحديث ثلاثة أحجار قلنا هذا خطأ بل كل حديث منها قائم بنفسه فلا يجزي من الأحجار إلا ثلاثة لا رجيع فيها ويجزي من التراب الوتر ولا يجزي غير ذلك من كل ما لا يسمى أرضا إلا الماء. فإن كان على حجر نجاسة غير رجيع أجزأ ما لم يأتي عنه نهي مما جاء عنه أن لا يجزي إلا ثلاثة أحجار سعيد بن المسيب والحسن وغيرهما. Say, and some people said that the hadith who does istijmar has to do witr is in contradiction to the hadith using three stones. We respond to him, this is wrong. It's not a contradiction because every hadith is stand alone by itself. It's not sufficient from the stones except three, which have no experiment on them. And from turab, you have to use witr, dust. So wipe once, fill your hand with dust again, wipe a second time, and wipe a third time. If it's clean, fine, then otherwise five, etc. ولا يجزي غير ذلك من كل ما لا يسمى anything which is not called ground. Anything called ground like salt, like sand is like turab, is like the earth because the earth and the turab. Except water which is having a distinguished situation which has no count and just purification. And if there's an impurity on a stone, it doesn't prevent it from using except if it's excrement because as you said, لا رجيع عليها, stones without رجيع on them. And anything which is not prohibited clearly and explicitly should not be. So if a stone is having, for example, a touch of blood, that's not a problem, provided this is digest blood, etc. And then he mentions further that this has been narrated that three stones are necessary. Sa'id ibn Musayyib, al-Hasan al-Ghairihima, that's also their point of view. That should be used three. Let's also continue. We'll have a general comment at the end, inshallah.
I forget what I'm about to say, it's just a quick one.
Yeah.
I can't remember, but someone told me once that a lot of mothers say you're allowed to use wood to clean yourself.
Wood is not regarded as earth. So, but I will come to that. It will come to the general argument.
How did they come to that conclusion? So you can use anything to clean yourself with, as long as
and paper and wood. Yeah, we will come to that, inshallah. فإن ذكر ذاكر حديثا 17 to the end of the page. No, it's actually it continues because it continue with the hadith until there will be the next page, but most of it is a footnote. So it will go to the page after next, page 113 until line 4, page 113, line 4. It's not very long because yeah. The second page, the next page is all of it is footnotes. 17 now in page 111 until line 4 in page 113. فإذ ذكر ذاك الحديث رواه من طريق ابن الحسين الحبراني عن أبي سعيد أو أبي سعد عن أبي هريرة مسندا من استجمر فليوتر من فعل فقد أحسن ومن لا فلا حرج فإن ابن الحسين مجهول وأبو سعيد وأسعد الخير كذلك. فإن ذكروا حديث ابن مسعود النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أبغني أحجارا فأتيت بحجرين وروثة فأخذ الحجرين وألقى روثة وقال إنها ركس فهذا لا حجة فيه لأن ليس في الحديث عليه السلام اكتفى بالحجرين وقد صح أمره عليه السلام له بأن يأتيه بأحجار فالأمر باقٍ لازم لا بد من إبقائه وعلى أن هذا الحديث قد قال فيه أن أبا إسحاق دلسه وقد رواه من طريق أبي إسحاق عن علقم وفيه أبغني ثلاثا. Okay, so this again further evidences and counter argument. He says, if they mention a hadith which is narrated from the way of Ibn al-Husayn al-Habrani from Abi Sa'id or Abi Sa'd from Abu Huraira with in a connected chain, who makes istijmar, he should do witr. Who does, he has done well, and who did not do is no problem. So it's not witr, it's not obligatory. That will be really an authority in that issue. Yeah. The answer is that Ibn al-Husayn is unknown, al-Habrani, and Abu Sa'id, Abu Sa'd, al-Khayr kadalik. They're two unknowns which they cannot be taken as authority. Let us see what he says.
So he refutes the hadith as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's unknown. One of them is definitely unknown. So,
so this guy who makes the commentary, he probably double checks.
Yeah, things. Yeah. Yeah. So and if they mention the hadith of Mas'ud, we're still translating that portion, that the Messenger of Allah said, get me some stones in plural. I brought him two stones and one dropping, animal dropping, camel dropping, which was hardened. He took the two stones and threw away the animal dropping, say it is riks, it's impure. Yeah. And this is, yeah. This is not an authority for them, because in this hadith, it is not clear that he was sufficed with the two stones. Maybe he ordered him, he throw this one and get me another stone. It's hadith does not say he got another stone, he did not order or he sufficed. If Ibn Mas'ud said, and he did istijmar with two only, this would have been a clear authority. But it does not say. So he threw that, just the stress in the hadith of Mas'ud is that he threw away the animal dropping. وقد صح أمره عليه السلام بأن يأتيه بأحجار. So the command that he ordered him to get him stones, and stones means three and upwards. So the command is still as it is. And there's no authority or no clear evidence that when he dropped that when he threw away that animal dropping, I say it's impure, that he did not order a further stone,
yeah.
or he was sufficient with the two.
Yeah.
And and we say we have narrated it from the way of Abu Ishaq from Alqama that he said, get me a third one. So an addition saying, get me a third one in another channel of narration in the same hadith. So it is not good. It's not sufficient authority and clear authority. Now from 5 until 8 at the end of this issue, and then we make the comment. فإن قيل إنما نهى عن العظم والروث لأنهما زاد إخواننا من الجن. قلنا نعم فكان ماذا؟ بل هذا موجب أن المستنجب إحداهما عاصي مرتين، إحداهما خلاف نص الخبر، والثاني تقديره زاد من نهى عن تقدير زاده، والمعصي لا تجزئ بدل الطاعة، ومن قال لا يجزئ بالعظم ولا باليمين الشافعي وأبو سليمان وغيرهما. This line 5 and 6. Some people say he prohibited using bones and animal dropping because there's a hadith that they are the bones are the food of our brothers from the jinn, and the food of the animals of the jinn. They said, well, what's the issue then? Who and so what? Hey, you are disobeying the Messenger of Allah in two things. First of all, not obeying the command not to use them for istinja, and secondly, by messing up with the food of the jinn. which you are supposed not to mess up with it, because they deserve to have the good food, so you're missing their food. So you're not doing good, let us say it in modern language, you're not doing good to the environment either. So neither you are doing well in these situations. And this obedience will not substitute for obedience. And he's commenting further, who is from the scholars who said istinja with bone or with the right hand is not mujza, is not sufficient or not valid, is Imam Shafi'i and Abu Sulaiman or Ghairim. Let's come to the general statement I'm coming to. Yeah. No, you can hold it, it's no problem. And the general comment we have made last time is that it would have been technically correct if the issue in purifying the two exits is a matter which is depending upon the action itself and not what's the result. Yeah, but the reality is that in the purification, in all issues of purification in Najasa, we have made a general rule and clarified it earlier, which is Ibn Hazm did not detect, unfortunately, and made all of some of his discussions are esoteric and useless, is that the issue there is removing, the issue is not to have a Najasa, to remove the Najasa. That's the main issue. For example, the Prophet once prayed, we mentioned that previously, with the sandals, and then during the Salah he dropped the sandals. So the Sahaba dropped the sandals. After the Salah he made Taslim, hadith is famous, unknown. He had sandals in the Salah, he has shoes, and then he dropped them, he took them at the side. So the Sahaba dropped the sandals, and after Salah, you know the hadith is very famous, it's an authority that you can pray in sandals. He turned to the Sahaba and said, why did you drop your sandals? He said, you dropped your sandals, we followed you. He said, don't do. Jibreel came to me and told me that there's a filth under them, so I dropped them. If anyone comes to the masjid, he should turn upside down his sandals or the bottom and see if there's any filth and wipe them strongly with the dust, if there's anything, until it is clean. So it's clear that in the case of Salah, you should not have impurity on your body, in the external of the body, because the impurity is inside your belly. That is not yet out. If it exits, the place of exit should be clean. Both urine and that's the only issue really, the essential issue. In the cleaning, there are certain etiquettes the Prophet has instructed. So the issue is the cleaning. You can clean it with water, you can clean it with, but if you take a handful of dust and wipe, like you don't have stone or water and you are the desert side, it sounds a bit outrageous for civilized people, but if you are in the desert side, you will know, you don't have water, you don't have stones, so what you use a handful of dust and wipe your, let's say, anus. If one wipe cleans, then you are clean, but you have disobeyed the messenger to do it three times. So take two others to be obedient to the messenger, to obey the two commands. Using three, the two others just for ibadah, for obeying the command. But the issue is to clean. And if three are not enough and still there are some traces, then you have to use five to obey the command with the same with the paper. Take a piece of paper, cut it, fold it, and clean it. Or a piece of wood. Now we come to the wood. Whatever you use it, except what has been strictly prohibited or ordered not to use.
With paper, do you have to do it three times?
Yeah, one piece, do one. Usually, one will not be enough, you will see it. One will definitely not be enough until you clean it. Do it three times with three pieces of paper. Fold one, sufficient.
If there's water there, you have to use the water.
No, no. If it's clean, khalas, you don't need that.
So, say you've got a bidet and you've got toilet paper.
Yeah, you can use the toilet paper, suffice with that. You don't need water. The moment it is clean, that's all what is there. No, you don't need to use water. No scholar said istijmar is not enough. If you use water, it's extra cleaning, it's nicer, but it's not necessary. Until it cleans. If it doesn't clean except for water, you have to use water. So anything which cleans, water is purifying, paper, wood, the words people have said wood, anything can be purified except what an instruction has come not to use.
Okay, according to Ibn Hazm, he says it's only stone.
No. He said stones which have no excrement on them, on the other side, because obviously you use the other side. No, the moment you use one side, khalas, you have to throw it away. Or if you find a stone which is obviously excrement is being used by someone else, you cannot use it. It's all etiquettes, obviously, etiquettes of cleaning. But if it has a blood spot, that's no problem.
Yeah.
That's his point of view. Yeah. So what has been clearly instructed is to use three, five, etc. stones. In the case of water or something, you to obey the command, beside the cleaning, to obey the command you have to do three times. So if your water is not running, But what if examined, you should have a shot and clean, another shot and a three shots. If it's enough, other five shots, etc. Try to be with it as much as you can. In the case of stinja,
yeah, it's the same
with water and everything. Try to be, because with the stajmar, with stanja, stinja, with water, stajmar with stones is. So he has not distinguished that the purpose of your purification is to remove the najasa. Besides, in the there's an certain etiquette which is there. So if you don't follow the etiquettes, you are disobedient in that, but the removal, the purification is valid because the najasa is gone. So that's the point. The point that refutes his one point, because he did not recognize the principle about najasa. They are physical existence. If they are removed, the command has been obeyed. If the command gives a certain procedure of doing it, but you don't follow the procedure and you remove them, you have removed, you are pure, but you are sinful because of disobedience. Two different things. It does not mean that your istinja is invalid and you are not pure. You are pure.
Yeah.
But you have committed a sin. Yeah?
Yeah.
You have committed a sin. Because he connected with that, the istinja is specified in this way, it is invalid if it's under the rule. But the question, are you after that pure or not? There's two questions. Yeah, you are disobedient the command. But is there impurity? There's no impurity. So the impurity is gone and you have disobeyed the command. Yeah. Obviously, there would be a school of thought.
The urine one as well.
The urine is open. You're facing the Qibla is also within only the defecation, not with urine, because the hadith has come not facing the Qibla with the. Actually. Actually, the hadith of Salman says clearly not facing the Qibla with urine or gha'it, with both facing the Qibla. But using the right hand is only for istijmar. You should avoid using the right hand for the aft.
Oh, that's what the hadith
but for, yeah.
Silent on
the urine, yeah, that's it. But while urinating, you don't face the Qibla. Otherwise, you can use the right hand if you wish. You can you can make any Y make by water, by any number. There's no water required in that. It is because this has not specified except for the istinja. So that's the point to clarify is that in all najasat, removal of the najasa is the requirement. If a procedure is prescribed, the procedure itself, following the procedure is an etiquette and following it is an ibadah.
Other objects like, I don't know, a plastic bag or metal.
Whatever removes it, whatever it is. Because we made a principle.
Is that allowed?
It should be, because
he's saying Imam Shafi said something about skin and this.
Yeah, he did not comment on that at all. He did not comment. Yeah? He didn't comment on that. But the issue is all the time is removing the najasa, and if you're using stones or earth, etc., it should be purifying. Other things which remove the najasa is also purifying, but it's very, very unlikely that we know paper will remove it clearly and clean. If it is done properly, it's cleaning as the stones. So this is by so the issue with the najasa is removing them. If there's a procedure for certain things prescribed, then complying with them is an etiquette which will become sinful or maybe not sinful if the hadith of Abu Huraira turns out to be correct, that it is, although this man is unknown and he has memorized, then it is only desirable. It's an etiquette.
Right.
And this will enforce the principle that's really, I have to check this hadith more thoroughly and see if there's another channel of narration strengthening it, etc. But the principle is that the moment the najasa is gone, you are ready for salah. You may have committed a minor sin, obviously. There's no threatening or no cursing of that or something like that. And like, for example, if you use bone to clean, so if you are clean, but you have mutilated the bone for your brothers from the jinn, whatever these jinn may be, the bacteria of the jinn, because the word jinn I mentioned earlier, is three. Yeah, Abdullah ibn Abbas said the jinns are three types. One type are the ones who are responsible yawm al-qiyamah. Another types are the ones who causes diseases like that, etc. And this is the hadith said that the plague is the pinching or the pricking of your brothers from or enemy from jinn. These are the bad bacteria. And the third type is like the snakes and so on, which hide at day and come at night. It's called also jinn. So the three types of jinn. So it may be food of the bacteria, and you are undermining the bacteria's food, and in damaging the environment, so to say. So, but this does not mean that you did not become pure. So the two issues have to be separated. The moment you separate them, many of these things will be clarified. Many of these issues will be clarified if we should we make a pause? You know where is the pause? If you بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We continue with issue 123. This will go from line 9 in page 113 until the second line in page 114. مسألة 123. وتطهير بول الذكر أي ذكر كان في أي شيء كان فبأن يرش الماء عليه رشا يزيل أثره، وبول الأنثى يغسل. فإن كان البول في الأرض أي بول كان فبأن يصب الماء عليه صبا يزيل أثره فقط. حدثنا أحمد بن محمد بن الجسور، حدثنا أحمد بن فضل الدينوري، حدثنا محمد بن جرير، حدثنا عمرو بن علي، حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي، حدثنا يحيى بن وليد عن محل بن خليفة الطائي، حدثنا أبو السمح قال كنت أخدم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأتي بحسن أو حسين فبال على صدره فدعا بماء فرش عليه ثم قال عليه السلام هكذا يصنع، يرش من الذكر ويغسل من الأنثى. Issue 123 and purification from the urine of the male, any male wherever it is, in any place, is that by showering it with water. It doesn't need to be rubbed or scrubbed or something. Just rush until it is all traces are gone. And the urine of a female to be washed. Yeah.
Scrubbed.
Yeah. Washing. Yeah. Washing. It's not enough just to pour water on it, you have to wash it. If the urine is on the earth or on the floor, whatever urine it is, then just by putting water in it until it disappears completely. By flushing it away. And if it's hard floor or soft floor until it sinks deep, of course. Okay. Reported told us Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Jasur, told us Ahmed ibn Fadl al-Dainuri, told us Muhammad ibn Jarir, told us Amr ibn Ali, told us Abd al-Rahman ibn Mahdi, told us Yahya ibn al-Walid from Mahal ibn Khalifa al-Ta'i, told us Abu Samh. He said, Abu Samh, I was serving the Messenger of Allah, and he was and Al-Hasan or Hussein, and they were small kids, they brought to him. One of them urinated on his chest because he was carrying him. So the Messenger of Allah called for water and then he spread on it without scrubbing, without taking, sprinkled on it until it is it's gone. And he said, that's the way to do it. You sprinkle the urine of the male and wash the urine of the female. So that's the evidence for the statement he said before. Then he continues from line 3 until line 11. حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد، حدثنا إبراهيم بن أحمد، حدثنا الفيربري، حدثنا البخاري، حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف، حدثنا مالك عن ابن شهاب، عن عبيد الله بن عبد الله بن عتبة، عن أم قيس بنت محصن أن أتت بابن لها صغير لم يأكل الطعام فأجلسه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على حجره فبال على ثوب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فدعا عليه السلام بماء فنضحه ولم يغسله. حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد، حدثنا ابراهيم بن احمد، حدثنا الفيربري، حدثنا البخاري، حدثنا موسى بن اسماعيل، حدثنا همام هو ابن لحيه، حدثنا اسحاق هو ابن ابي وابن عبد الله بن ابي طلحه عن انس بن مالك ان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم راى اعرابيا يبول في المسجد فدعا بماء فصب عليه. تولد عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد، تولد ابراهيم بن احمد، تولد الفيربري، تولد البخاري. That's his isnad from Bukhari, one of his isnad. تولد عبد الله بن يوسف، تولد مالك from ابن شهاب. From عبيد الله بن عبد الله بن عتبة، from أم قيس بنت محصن. She brought a son of her, a small son, who did not eat food yet. And the messenger put it on his lap. And the boy urinated on him, on the dress of the thobe, of the clothes of the messenger of Allah. The messenger of Allah called for water and then sprinkled it and did not wash it. Washing, you have to. تولدس عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد، تولدس إبراهيم بن أحمد، تولدس الفيربري، تولدس البخاري، تولدس موسى بن إسماعيل، تولدس همام، همام this همام is ابن يحيى، تولدس إسحاق، إسحاق is this ابن عبد الله بن أبي طلحة، from أنس بن مالك that a messenger of Allah saw a Bedouin urinating in the masjid, so he ordered water to be poured on that urine. I think this is clear. We'll continue with the evidence first, then we see the comment. Here's the comment. Another comments come from line 13 until second line in the next page. That's line 13, page 114 to second line in page 115. قال علي ليس تحديد ذلك بأكل الصبي الطعام من كلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وممن فرق بين بول الغلام وبول الجارية أم سلمة أم المؤمنين وعلي بن أبي طالب ولا مخالف لهم من الصحابة رضي الله عنهم، وبه يقول قتادة والزهري. وقال مضت السنة بذلك، وعطاء بن أبي رباح والحسن البصري وإبراهيم النخعي وسفيان الثوري والأوزاعي والشافعي وأحمد بن حنبل وإسحاق بن راهوية وأبو ثور وداود بن علي وابن وهب وغيرهم، إلا أنه قد روي عن الحسن وسفيان التسوية بين بول الغلام والجارية في الرش عليهما جميعا. علي سيد أسأل أبو الحزم: The specification that this boy did not eat the food is not from the statement of the messenger of Allah. His mother said it was a small boy, he did not eat food. That's all. This is just a description, a fact that it happened to be like that. But the messenger of Allah said that I'm just sprinkling it because he did not eat food. That would be a reason. Some people said from this hadith we conclude only those who did not eat food. The one who above started eating food, you have to wash it or something. And this is from their imagination.
Up to what age do you sprinkle them?
All ages, say all male until he dies, and all female until they die. Ibn Hazm, No, this is clear from the Nas. And the hadith of Abu Samh, which the messenger of Allah said clearly, if Abu Samh hadith is valid, there's some objection to it, but if it is valid, he said, so you do with the urine of the male, and you wash from the urine of the female. Clearly specifying it's male and female, not specifying any age. So that statement of the messenger of Allah there makes clearly that there is distinction between male and female, without specifying an age or eating food. Hadith al-Bukhari, there is an age of that mentioned, but it's mentioned as a part of the story, is not a reason connected with the washing or sprinkling only. So the people said you sprinkle until they eat food, and then if they eat food all the rest of their life, you wash all of them. That's based on imagination, not any nas. Okay. So okay. His conclusion is correct. His conclusion is correct.
So no, if I accidentally urinate on my clothes, sufficient for me just to get some water
until the traces are gone. Sprinkling is not sprinkling, that means the urine is there. The urine has gone because it's still najasa. It's not rubbing, not washing, not a washing machine, not taking out and washing.
Okay, so
but just pour water on it.
Pour water
until it is gone. There's no urine smell or something.
Like
no. It's
that does make sense if you think about it. If it's a female one, then you rub it.
No.
Why should it just be related to children and not?
No.
Okay, I'm with you.
Now, Ali comments. We stopped there, actually commented a little bit too much. The specification that he did not eat food is not from the statement of the Messenger of Allah. It just happened to be the situation. And then he mentions now who has made the distinction between the urine of the boy and the urine of the woman is Umm Salama, the mother of the believer, the wife of the Prophet, Ali ibn Abi Talib. And no report from the rest of the Sahab indicate anyone dissenting. So these two stated clearly that the urine of the boy has to be is enough to sprinkle or flood it over, and the urine of the girls has to be washed. Salama and Ali ibn Abi Talib said that specifically, and there is no dissenting view from any other Sahabi, neither positive nor negative. Some people regard that as an ijma', and this is the statement also of Qatada and Zuhri from the Tabi'in, and Zuhri said Madat al-Sunnah bidak. The Sunnah has been established like that. The Sunnah he knows from all previous scholars, so from Sahaba and all the Tabi'in.
They're not bothered about adult or child, basically.
No, just out. Yeah, they didn't specify anything. He did not discuss this point at all. وعطاء بن أبي رباح والحسن البصري إبراهيم النخعي وسفيان الثوري ذي التابعين. عطاء بن أبي رباح والحسن البصري إبراهيم النخعي say the same. سفيان الثوري والأوزاعي والشافعي وأحمد بن حنبل وإسحاق بن راهوية ذي التابعين and later also أبو ثور داود بن علي the founder of the Zahiri school وابن وهب وغيرهم these are scholars of hadith. إلا أنه قد روي عن الحسن وسفيان it has been narrated from الحسن and سفيان الثوري that they made the urine of boys and girls and men and women equal in that they can be just by pouring water on them. Now he comes to Abu Hanifa, who usually has his own complicated distinction. وقال أبو حنيفة ومالك والحسن بن حي نوس ومالك والحسن بن حي يوصل بول الصبي كبول الصبية وما نعلم متعلقا لا من قرآن ولا من سنة ولا من قول الصاحب نعم ولا عن أحد من التابعين إلا أن بعض المتأخرين ذكر ذلك عن النخعي والمشهور عنه خلاف ذلك وقوله عن سعيد بن مسيب الرش من الرش والصب من الصب من الأبوال كلها هذا نصا خلاف قولهم وبالله تعالى التوفيق أبو حنيفة عن مالك عن حسن بن حي said you have to wash both from the urine of the boy and the urine of the girl. And we don't find any evidence for them from Quran or Sunnah or a statement of any companion. And not even from the Tabi'een, except some later people claim that al-Nakhai, Ibrahim al-Nakhai, was a major scholar of the Tabi'een and regarded as the faqih number one of the Tabi'een of Kufa, has said the same, but this is not even the well-established narration from him. Nakhai is more in the earliest, that's men and women are different, in my opinion. And also, it's been narrated from Sa'id al-Musayyib, said rush from rush and sub from sub. Because the boy is actually sprinkles, so you sprinkle his urine, and the girl drains, so you drain her. So he's using it like a metaphor, because the way a boy urinates is different than a girl, and so this is what Sa'id ibn Musayyib said from all urine types like that, and this is definitely not their statement when they made it equal, and Allah is guiding us to the right way. Now. Yeah, that's what Sa'id ibn Musayyib said. But the reality is that this is only for humans, obviously. Now, for animals, it will come. Some people say the animals, you can eat their flesh, their urine is not najis, etc. There's many discussions which will come later. So don't worry about that. But some scholars broke their head about why there's a difference between the urine of boy and girl. It may be ibadah, it may be the urine of the girl, of the woman, is having another composition. It seems to me it has some sexually attractive materials. What they call Aphrodite, pheromones, or whatever they call it. No. Materials which you don't smell consciously, but subconsciously excite you sexually or something like that. It may be, at least for adult women, very sexually attractive materials in female urine, which is not the male. So there's definitely a physiological difference, but it's not relevant. It's a place where male and female have been distinct. Some people reason that because girls do not sprinkle, so the urine may touch the aft. And get mixed with some experiment. It may be the reason. Allahu alam, we don't know. It is wasting time with the reason is not relevant. If you want to be in the safe side, wash from everyone. Then you are in the safer side anyway. Because just pouring water on the male urine does not prevent you from using even the stronger way of washing it. And most people will wash anyway. They will not feel very happy to leave any. Just wash the urine away. But just pouring the water until it is all gone is enough. While it's still on you, if you can't tolerate that. Most of the time, maybe you cannot. It's just a small amount or something like that. So it is just a matter of a scholarly, really intellectual exercise rather than practically the case. Now, next issue from line 8 until line 11 in that page, in page 115.
Why do they use the word sprinkle then? Because sprinkle to me just means get a bit of water and just do that.
They use the word rush. Or the opposite, rush al-ma does not mean necessary. For example, if you stand under the drain from the roof, it's called sprinkling also in Arabic. Like a dush and a shower until it's completely wet and drained. Because if there's a urine, the najasa is there.
So in Arabic, you say a shower is a sprinkle.
Yeah. Even a sufficient amount that all urine is gone. It has to be, otherwise, the urine is not gone. You don't need room with a najasa. Means that it's not najas in the first place. Yeah. So it's actually sab alayhi, pouring on it rather than sprinkling. Or sufficient sprinkling until it's gone. Because they didn't have even sprinkling device at that. They have some scrub and then you pour over it or you take it in your hand.
Yeah.
That's what they call it, rush. Yeah. So from line 8 to 11, issue 124, مثلا 124 وتطهير دم الحيض وأي دم كان سواء دم سمك كان أو غيره إذا كان في الثوب أو الجسد فلا يكون إلا بالماء حاشا دم البراغيث ودم الجسد فلا يلزم تطهيرهما إلا ما لا حرج من غسله على الإنسان فيطهر المرء ذلك حسب ما لا مشقة عليه فيه. And this will discuss that in the end also. He said, and purifying from the blood of menstruation or any other blood, including the blood of fish, we'll come to that, or anything else, if it is in the body or in the clothes, can be only done with water. It cannot be done with dust or stones, except the blood of ticks and fleas and mosquitoes and things like that, and the blood of the body itself when you bleed from the scratch and you have a bleeding, etc. It is not obligatory to clear them. Except when it is easy to do with water. But if it's uneasy or inaccessible, it is not obligatory to clean it. and you clear, you clean from that as much as you can with any mean from the body, body blood, and the small insects and parasites and so on. We will comment on that, so don't ask anything. We're from line 12 and until 18, he gets that the evidences for that. Told us Abdullah, حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف, حدثنا أحمد بن فتح, حدثنا عبد الوهاب بن عيسى, حدثنا أحمد بن محمد, حدثنا أحمد بن علي, حدثنا مسلم بن الحجاج, حدثنا أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة وأبو كريب قال جميعا, حدثنا وكيع عن هشام بن عروة عن أبي عن عائشة قالت جاءت فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت يا رسول الله إني امرأة استحاض فلا أطهر أفأدع الصلاة؟ قال لا, إنما ذلك عرق وليست بالحيضة, فإذا أقبلت الحيضة فدع الصلاة, فإذا أدبر فاغسلي عنك الدم وصلي. وهدع منه صلى الله عليه وسلم نوع الدم, ولا نبالي بالسؤال إذا كان جو عليه السلام قائما بنفسه غير مردود بضمير إلى السؤال. Okay, and his comment is also is bad. We have to comment later. From line because his theory of purity is again not correct. Yeah. From line 12 until 18, told us Abdullah ibn Yusuf, told us Ahmed ibn Fath, told us Abdullah ibn Isa, told us Ahmed ibn Muhammad, told us Ahmed ibn Ali, told us Musa ibn al-Hajjaj, told us Abu Bakr ibn Shayba, and Abu Qurayb. Both said, told us Waqi' from Hisham ibn Urwa, from his father, from Aisha. She said, Fatima ibn Abi Hubaysh came to the Messenger of Allah and said, O Messenger of Allah, I have bleeding, not menstruation, bleeding. So it never stops. Yeah, that's should I leave Salah? He said, no, this is only a vein which is broken. And it's not the menstruation, because the menstruation is not a broken vein, it is the internal skin of the uterus being shed out, because there was no fertilization of the egg, so it's essentially different. So if when the time of your menstruation or the clear blood of the menstruation comes, then leave the salah. When that's gone, then wash the blood from you and pray. Okay? And he said this is the generalization from him, the Messenger of Allah, for the type of blood. And we don't care if the question was about menstruation, and about hayd, etc., because his statement, the Messenger of Allah, is standing alone without being referred to the question. But this is, I have to comment here quickly, this is wrong, because she's asking specifically about the main issue there is the salah. Yeah? You cannot take it. He's taking it out of context. As if he said, wash the blood from you, addressing the people in the masjid. That's not the situation. This is really cutting the hadith in pieces, which is not legitimate, neither in Arab language nor necessity of reason. Because he's saying, this is the menstruation, this is a normal blood, this is the irq. So pray as usual, and then when the time of haydak has come, if then else, he's making an if, and then it's conditional. You cannot disconnect the condition for it. This is logically not possible. I am wondering about Ibn Hazm being a logical man, goes in such a trap. If when the haidah comes and she sees it, it's clear the blood of the haid, or another way by counting the days, but it's clear that it's a menstruation, when you see the color of the blood changes and become the dark and the dark black bad smelling blood of haid. Women distinguish that, they know the difference between bleeding if you injure your hand and the haid, the menstruation blood, the distinction is clear. When the menstruation comes, then leave the salah. And the menstruation is gone, then he said, wash from you the blood and pray. He said, wash from you the blood I'm just mentioning, that of the haida, not the blood before that. Otherwise, he said, wash the blood every time and pray. And then when the haida come, don't pray. He did not say that. So you see, Ibn Hazm is making really, unfortunately, not a good conclusion here. So the blood has to be washed is the blood of menstruation. Yeah?
Yeah.
And then pray. And then you stay in this situation until the next menstruation. So he's not talking about any blood or general blood, he's talking about the blood of menstruation, nothing else. That blood of menstruation, by this,
Ibn Hazm is saying,
all bloods, including fish blood and everything. No.
Okay, yeah, I understand.
Yeah, that's the conclusion is wrong. That hadith is not an authority here. For him, it's authority because he said, when the menstruation has come, because if he wanted the blood to be before that, the previous of irq, but he said, wash the blood every time, clean your vagina, have maybe a towel or something like that if you cannot stop it, because sometimes you cannot stop it, so you have to pray with it. So hold it with something like that, wash it, hold it, and then pray. No, he said pray. Don't leave the salah. Not specifying what to do in the case of bleeding, generally.
So could you conclude from that, if you're bleeding?
We'll come to the conclusion. That's very clear. I'm just saying his point that every blood is wrong.
Yeah.
It said, this is not a menstruation, this is just a broken vein.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it, pray. until your menstruation comes, which you can recognize whatever mean, either by timing or by, but she knows how to recognize it. Yeah. He assuming she's a woman, she knows what's menstruation. This is reality, women know. When your menstruation has come, then leave the salah, because she's asking about salah, not about washing. And then after that, he gives her a further instruction. Yes, he's giving an extra. And if the menstruation is gone, then wash the blood of the menstruation, evidently, and start praying. And stay in this state until the next. If it would have been, the other blood would have been najis and need to be cleaned, he should have told her that. But this is actually an evidence against Bilhad. Unfortunately, I don't know how that's different than if he was the masjid, say, people, wash the blood from your clothes. That would be any blood. But that's not here. That's definitely in a certain context. He's taking it very badly out of context, which I must say, really, it's not good for an intelligent scholar and faqir. That's one of the places where he blunders badly. Yeah, this is the Zahiri. Zahiri is really like that. We see that, we follow the nas, the whole nas has to be taken. You cannot cut it in pieces. It is connected, because you say, when the menstruation comes, leave the salah. When the menstruation goes away, adbarat, finishes, then wash the blood and pray. And pray. It's not that it says in the masjid addressing everyone, wash the blood on your clothes and pray. That's not the same. That's definitely not the same. This is rationally not acceptable. So you're talking out of context and cutting it, which is not correct. Against his principle of taking all evidences together. That's not correct. And he said, we don't care if this washing the blood has come as a response to this question or the other question. No, we care. It cares. Otherwise, the meaning does not become correct. So it's very unfortunate that he raised this blunder. So only the menstruation blood by this evidence must be washed. And hence we conclude it is najis, because he is ordering it to be washed, so it is najis. It has to be. And it's clear that what you wash at the end of the menstruation is the remaining of it in the body, in the vagina, or in the cloth. So take the clothes out and wash them, and wash the place of exit of blood, the exit point of the blood, the vagina. The further evidence will clarify that further. Line 19, which shows that Ibn Hazm is unfortunately mistaken in that. Take that bit of evidence alone, that hadith. حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد حدثنا إبراهيم بن أحمد حدثنا الفرابري حدثنا البخاري. This is Bukhari إسناد most importantly. حدثنا محمد بن مثنى حدثنا يحيى he is ابن سعيد القطان عن هشام بن عروة حدثتني فاطمة هي بنت المنذر بن الزبير عن أسماء هي ابنة أبي بكر الصديق قالت أتت امرأة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت رأيت إحدانا تحيض في الثوب كيف تصنع؟ قالت تحته ثم تقرصه بالماء وتنضحه وتصلي فيه. Told us عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد. Told us إبراهيم بن أحمد. Told us الفرابري. Told us البخاري. Told us محمد بن مثنى. Told us يحيى. Meaning يحيى بن سعيد القطان. The famous Imam. From هشام بن عروة. Told me فاطمة. This is فاطمة بنت المنذر بن زبير. It's actually he's the wife of هشام. At the same time. Told me فاطمة the daughter of المنذر بن زبير. From أسماء. Meaning أسماء بنت أبي بكر الصديق. Famous أسماء. Said a woman came to the messenger of Allah and asked, Do you see if one of us menstruating her clothes, and the clothes have obviously menstruation blood spots. What to do? كيف تصنع? He said, scratch it, meaning clean. ثم تقرصه بالماء, wash it, قرص, pinch it with water, and then even drain the water from it again, pour water on it, then she can play in it. So clean it thoroughly. Yeah? Scrub it with water, then pour water on it so it is gone, except maybe a bit of yellowish and so on, but it's really the blood essence is gone, just only maybe a remaining color, and pray in it. So it's clear that she's asking about the menstruation blood, not about the shiny blood of the Chinese emperor. That's very clear, that's nothing. She's menstruating in her clothes. Next piece of evidence will clarify that further, show that Ibn Hazm made a bad blunder here, unfortunately. From 1 to 11 in page 116, it says, ويستحب أن يستعمل في غسل المحيض شيئا من مسك حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن خالد حدثنا إبراهيم بن أحمد حدثنا الفرابري حدثنا البخاري حدثنا يحيى حدثنا ابن عيينة عن منصور بن صفية عن أمه عن عائشة أن امرأة سألت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن غسلها من المحيض فأمرها كيف تغتسل قال خذي فرصة من مسك فتطهري بها قالت كيف أتطهر بها قال سبحان الله تطهري بها فاجتذبت إليها فقلت تتبعي بها أثر الدم حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف، حدثنا احمد بن فتح، حدثنا عبد الوهاب بن عيسى، حدثنا احمد بن محمد، حدثنا احمد بن علي، حدثنا مسلم بن الحجاج، مسلم اسناد، حدثنا احمد بن سعيد الدارمي، حدثنا حبان هو ابن هلال، حدثنا وهيب، حدثنا منصور هو ابن صفيه عن امه عن عائشه ان امراه سالت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كيف اغتسل عند الطهر؟ قال خذي فرصه ممسكه فتوضئي بها. ثم ذكر نحو حديث سفيان. Let me read that حديث. Is this the same hadith in two channels of narration? It is, he said, for starting, it is desirable to use, to remove the last traces of menstruation, to use a little bit of musk or something perfumed. Told us Abdurrahman ibn Abdullah ibn Khalid, told us Ibrahim ibn Ahmad, told us al-Firabri, told us al-Bukhari, told us Yahya, told us ibn Uyayna, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, from Mansur ibn Safiyyah, the son of Safiyyah, from his mother, from Aisha, a woman asked the messenger of Allah about her purification from menstruation. He ordered her to تغتسل, to wash herself completely. And he said, take a fursa, take a bit or a piece of cloth soaked in musk.
Sorry, hang on. As I always move it, you should change your battery or switch.
We're still there.
I can't understand why.
No, it was like kind of.
You should change your battery or switch. Because it's done this thing. Okay. Maybe that switch wasn't working properly.
Make sure that next time, let's see.
No, because I double checked as well. So.
Just continue. We cut this piece, inshallah, in the future. Continue.
What's happened? It's on record.
Yeah, it's recording.
No, it's not moving though. Mm-hmm.